Good friends are very forgiving of each other, and of me also. And so, I wanted to mention there was a woman who asked Abdul Baha, Annie Sreidhout was her name. This account is published in the Star of the West. She asked Abdul Baha, how can we teach the faith? What's the best way? How best can we teach the cause? And Abdul Baha said, to live the life. Live the life. He said three times, live the life. And then he said, in order to live the life, you must attain thirst for spirituality. It isn't just that you decide I'm going to be good. That's not enough. You have to have attraction and thirst for spiritual matters, for spiritual things. That will lead you to the capacity to live the life. To live the life, of course, is a life of illumination. Abdul Baha says, you want to teach the faith, he said, you must become incarnate light. From the top of your head to the bottom of your feet should be shining with light. A light that he could see, but we probably wouldn't see in each other. I don't know how that works. Now, then he goes on to say, in order to attain this thirst for spirituality, you must study the holy books with regard to the subject of immortality. Especially the writings of Baha'u'llah, he says, and the other holy books, study about life after death, about immortality. If you do that, if you study those, you will attain thirst for spirituality. If you have a thirst for spirituality, you will be able to live the life. If you live the life, you will teach effectively. Your words will have effect on people. This is not a course on immortality, but it's related in the sense because the manifestation and his successors have, in this dispensation, revealed tremendous oceans, really, of knowledge about the other world that before it was simply there was heaven, there was hell, and that was it. But now we have so many more details about it. And interestingly enough, in recent times, I think part of the things that's helping is the near-death experiences that are being reported, finally being recorded, being studied, being analyzed, of people who've been temporarily pronounced dead and yet have had some very intense experience. And this is leading the scientists now to postulate that consciousness is independent of the body. It exists without the body. So the body dies, doesn't matter, consciousness is still going to be there. And this is a big step, and from the scientific point of view. I spoke to a professor in the University of Rome, and he said he thinks it's about 30 years. He's written some terrific tomes published by Oxford on biology and so on. He thinks it's about 30 years before that they will finally say clearly consciousness is independent of the body. It acts through the brain and through the body, but it exists on its own. For instance, in the writings it talks about, Baha'u'llah says, we've left the dream in human reality so that it can not, that the existence of the soul cannot be denied, the soul being that kind of consciousness. So when we dream, our eyes are shut, our ears are not hearing anything, and we're asleep, and yet we see things, we speak. We have joy, we have fear, we have, sometimes we eat something interesting in a dream, even. We see in technicolor, terrific things, and yet our body is completely asleep and not registering things. What's happening? How is this possible? So how much more in this near-death experience people are registering things, but there's no impulse coming through the brain at all. And now recently they've talked about how the heart reacts to events and possible things that are happening around it before the brain even operates, recognizes it. This is a new kind of, you know, in the Baha'i teachings and in the teachings of the East, the heart is the center of consciousness, not the brain, in the body. And then it's not just the physical heart, obviously it's the heart beyond that, the heart of our being, so to speak. And he says that heart is like a mirror and it has to be cleansed. And we'll get into that when we read the passage about the true secret tomorrow morning. We have this particular section of the gleanings centered on the names and attributes of God and the evidence of the revelation of those names in all the degrees of existence. So it's in the mineral kingdom, the vegetable kingdom, the animal kingdom, the human kingdom. It's in the spirit of faith and the manifestation of himself. All these, we see all these wonders before us. And the recognition of first the oneness of God, and then the recognition of the manifestations of God and their greatness is enhanced by our observing what are referred to here as the signs of God. The signs of God in creation. The signs of the names and attributes of God in all existing things. And we're called upon to meditate about that. And he says that, you know, we'll read these passages here where he says, you put the signs in your own selves, will you not then behold them? And also, we've shown them our signs in the world and within themselves. We were talking yesterday about the wonders of the body, all the different functions that are going on. All these are signs, and they should be wonders, but we've gotten to the point where we're so materialistic in our outlook that science just defines these as functions. And we take the magic away from them. That this is part of the creation of God, and this is one of the ways he communicates to us, is through the wonders of our own existence and the beauties of the things we see around us and the mysteries of science that are the human consciousness and the powers of the soul draw out of nature. We shouldn't know these things, but because we're superior to nature, entirely in consciousness, we're able to examine the laws of nature and use them against nature. Nature says you can't fly in the air, you have to stay on the ground. Well, we figured out how to fly. We also figured out how to shoot airplanes down, but that's another story. Okay, friends, this is a long paragraph, but a very interesting paragraph. And we can discuss these things a bit more after that. I need a mic, we can have this one if you want. Do we have another mic here? Section 90, that's right, what you have before you.
Page 27,
okay? We reversed this morning's and this is this evening's program. Okay, please.
Whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth is a direct evidence of the revelation within it of the attributes and names of God. Inasmuch as within every atom are enshrined the signs that bear eloquent testimony to the revelation of that most great light. Methinks, but for the potency of that revelation, no being could ever exist. How resplendent the luminaries of knowledge that shine in an atom, and how vast the oceans of wisdom that surge within a drop. To a supreme degree is this true of man, who, among all created things, hath been invested with the robe of such gifts and hath been singled out for the glory of such distinction. For in him are potentially revealed all the attributes and names of God to a degree that no other created being hath excelled or surpassed. All these names and attributes are applicable to him, even as he hath said, "Man is my mystery, and I am his mystery." Manifold are the verses that have been repeatedly revealed in all the heavenly books and the holy scriptures, expressive of this most subtle and lofty theme. even as he hath revealed. We will surely show them our signs in the world and within themselves. And again he saith, and also in your own selves, will ye not then behold the signs of God? And yet again he revealeth, and be ye not like those who forget God, and whom he hath therefore caused to forget their own selves. In this connection, he who is the eternal King, may the souls of all that dwell within the mystic tabernacle be a sacrifice unto him, hath spoken. He hath known God who hath known himself.
In the center of this paragraph is a line that says, all these names and attributes are applicable to him, lowercase him, to human beings, in other words. We're told that potentially we can manifest ourselves, reflect on, radiate the names and attributes of God. Potentially, we need to have this spiritual rebirth and the implications of attaining to the goal of the true seeker, and then we shine with all these attributes. Quite interesting. We are told that one of the names that we represent, that we reflect, is oneness. So all of us reflect the names and attributes, can reflect the names and attributes of God. But at the same time, we reflect the name of God, the unique. So each of us reflects the names and attributes of God in a different proportions than anybody else. It's like the question of everything is singular, if you really look carefully. Every thumbprint is different. Every leaf on every tree is different. So every human soul is unique, potentially. Now, Abdu'l-Bahá wanted to establish, the one actually that Abdu'l-Bahá, the Baha'u'lláh commanded him to reveal in Baghdad when he was a teenager, when someone asked the meaning of one of the traditions of Islam. It happened to be the tradition that I was a hidden treasure and desired to be known, therefore I created thee that thou mightest know me. And Abdu'l-Bahá writes a terrific treatise on that subject. The last of the four sections is about to know me. What does it mean? What is the knowledge of God? What are the mysteries of the knowledge of God inherent in that verse? And there he responds to a question that the seeker had projected, and that is, why is it that the great spiritual mystics, the ones who are most profound in their knowledge and explanations about God and the Beloved One and so on, differ in the way they speak? And Abdu'l-Bahá states there, he says, this is because of the dominant name of God in their character. Each one has a dominant name of God. So the implication is that we all have a dominant name. And that we filter things through that, that's the most powerful of the names that manifested in us. But obviously there's a spectrum. If it's all the names of God, there's this infinite possibility that you have more of this name than of that name, of that attribute, of this attribute. So we all are the embodiment of these names and attributes of God. And all of that is wonderful. We don't have to be the same. We don't have to all be the manifestation of the name of the wise one or the all-knowing. We might be the one of the compassionate, the ever-loving, the kind, the merciful. We know, you know, people, you see Baha'is, radiant Baha'is, they're not necessarily terribly deepened in scriptural matters, but they know the heart of the faith and they express it. In the United States, we say big mamas. The kind of women that are big mamas, they just attract you in the sense because they're compassionate and understanding, and you know that they embrace you with their kindness and their love and their understanding. And young people like that. Everybody likes that. So what does that tell us? This is my own understanding of the subject, but if we don't develop the reflection of the set of names and attributes in us, and manifest those in life, the world order of Baha'u'llah will be deprived of that expression of the names of God that you, only you, and you alone can contribute. And you think to yourself, what am I, you know, worthless little being? What significance? There's so many Baha'is, let them do the work, I'm not going to do it. This is, no, everybody has a contribution to make. You should seek out the destiny God has for you. He's fixed the destiny on every soul, and we should seek it out. We can't just relax about it. You know, in that passage that I was quoting to you yesterday about being ushered into the presence of the manifestations of God and the messengers of the past, and they're asking us what we've experienced, what we've suffered in the path of God. In that same passage, a little long, you're talking about what are the activities of the souls when they go to the next world. And very shortly after that, he says, they will wish to witness the reality of every sanctified soul. They will wish to witness the reality of every sanctified soul. They'll be looking to see the souls, one after the other. Why is that? Because each soul reveals the names of God in a different way. Each soul gives us insight into the nature of these names that every other soul won't do. So we've been looking at the lives of these great heroes and thinking about that. They've manifested these names and attributes in a way that moves us. In the next world, we'll have an opportunity to meet them. We can meet the holy ones of all ages. You know, you don't have the problem of they're gone or they're... Now, we're told we won't understand the station of those above us, but it doesn't mean that we won't see them, we can't visit them, we can't be in touch with them. It's just that we don't completely penetrate the station they may obtain. He said we understand those that are on the same level with us and those that are below us. And Baha'u'llah gives the key to where we're going to be positioned in the next world. He says, light seeks light and the company of its kind. If you're spiritually attractive and you rejoice in the manifestation, you will be with those who are spiritually attractive and rejoice in the manifestation. If you're sneaky and conniving, you will be with the sneaky and conniving souls, and you'll have to suffer the consequences of seeing yourself reflected in everybody else. The liars will all be together. My word, pleasant word that will be. Never mind those people who excess in sexual matters or all the disturbing things, criminals, cheats, everything else. Likes its like and the company of its kind. Rhea Kahneman took up this theme about the characterization of each of the individuals with one of the names of God in a play that she wrote called The Growing Pains of a Spiritual Assembly. And it's been a long time since I've read it, but the idea of it is the assembly comes together and we have Mr. Wisdom and we have Mrs. Mercy and we have Mr. Justice and we have, so in the consultation, any subject that comes up, the Mr. Justice will say, no, we have to apply the law of God here. We can't just ignore that. I mean, people can't just do what they want. They have to be told how to. And then Mrs. Mercy says, God help us, we're all so weak. We should be, one of us should be compassionate. Let the assembly be understanding and forgiving and encouraging of the friends. We're like the mother or the father for the people. You know? And the Wisdom strokes his beard and he says it, or whatever he says it. So they all, and any subject that comes, they will all have the same point of view. And somehow Baha'u'llah has decided that if you can get 9 people together, contributing from their singular set of names and attributes of God, somehow they'll come out with something that would be okay. I mean, I used to meet with national assemblies in the old days as a counselor, and you would hear arguments to the death between the members that how we should do things, and this is the only way to do it, that's the only way to do it. I would suggest to them, you know, if you're united, any one of those things would be fine. It's not that there's one that eliminates all the others. Just go forward in unity. If you can find a way to go forward in unity, that's the way to act in the cause. So, you want to be remembering, how can I how can I reach my destiny? And praying, the prayers and prayers and meditations, you can find passages that says, you know, all I choose is that which thou hast chosen for me. And we shouldn't be ambitious beyond that in any way. We should want to do what God wants us to do, and play that role. And that will give us contentment, and that will be pleasing to the Lord, pleasing to God. So we understand. Behold the signs in the world. I mean, just, you could all sit down and make a list of the wonders before us. Look how the sea provides the clouds that then come over and water the lands, or how seeds so small produce plants that then produce fruits or food that we can eat. All of it is miraculous. We get kind of stayed in our view because maybe it hasn't been taught us as miraculous in school. We just take it for granted. Oh, that's nature, you know, that's what they did. We lose the wonder of the signs of God that He's placed in us and in the world to create this affirmation of Him. Since we can't know Him in His essence, we know Him in His works. We know Him in His signs. And we should be asking Him to open my eyes that I might behold the world in the manner in which you wish me to behold the world. Because the world, on the one hand, is a veil. We're told how dangerous the world is. Renounce the world. Turn away from the world. But there's the flip side of that, that the world is the face of God. That the world is one place where everything happens according to His will, except the human activities. But I mean, all the lower kingdoms, they are an immediate expression of the will of God. The cohesion of the minerals, the growing of plants, the animal kingdom and all of its wonders. All of these things are there. They should be thrilling us. They should be uplifting us. Have we gotten bored with God's creation? He who forgets God, it says here, what does it say here? This is interesting. And be ye not like those who forget God, and whom He hath therefore caused to forget their own selves. It's quite a challenge, no? Now He tells us we should be remembering God. If we're not remembering God, which is repeating the verses of God and the prayers of God, I think we fall into this category of having forgotten God. Negligent. So that's something I think it's good for us to bear in mind. The last is of this paragraph, it says, He who is the eternal being. This is also referenced in the writings to the Imam Ali. May the souls of all that dwell within the mystic tabernacle be a sacrifice of them. That's spoken. And of course, this would be very significant that Baha'u'llah was quoting from Ali for the uncle of the Bab, who was a very devoted Shia himself. And then we have the repetition in the last line of what we were talking about yesterday. He hath known God who hath known Himself. My light is in thee. Get thou from thy radiance. Turn thy sight unto thyself that thou mayest find me standing within thee, mighty, powerful, and self-subsisting. You think yourself a puny being, he said, in the universe. And all of its powers are encompassed in the soul. It can penetrate, it can understand everything. Amazing statements. This is also in our Kitab-e Iman. Okay, we have another paragraph here. Can you read that for us?
From that which hath been said, it becometh evident that all things in their inmost reality testify to the revelation of the names and attributes of God within them, each according to its capacity, indicative, and is expressible of the knowledge of God. So potent and universal is this revelation that it hath encompassed all things, visible and invisible. Thus hath it been revealed. Hath aught else gave thee a power of revelation which is not possessed by thee, that it could have manifested thee? Blind is the eye which doth not perceive thee. Likewise hath the Eternal King spoken. No thing have I perceived except that I perceive God in it, God before it, or God after it. Also in the tradition of Kamayal it is written, behold, a light hath shone forth out of the morn of eternity, and lo, its ways have penetrated the inmost reality of all men. Man, the noblest and most perfect of all created things, excelleth them all in the intensity of his revelation, and is a fuller expression of his glory. And of all men, the most accomplished, the most distinguished, and the most excellent are the manifestations of the Son of Truth. Nay, all else besides these manifestations live by the operation of their will, and move and have their being through the outpourings of their grace.
These manifestations themselves, again, so mysterious that we really can't penetrate and understand their reality. We witness the effects of their light within our own souls, our own consciousness. And they state that they witness the effects of God's revelation, the radiance of God within their souls, so that they are the primal mirrors of the light of God, and we're the secondary mirrors. Another level. Again, live by the operation of their will, move and have their being through the outpourings of their grace. We are completely dependent on the power of the manifestation to be alive and to exist. There is no other power that sustains physical creation and existence, we're being told. So again, reflect upon the signs of God in the world and within our own selves. It is an essential consideration. You see something beautiful, rejoicing in it, that it's been made by the Maker. It's a wonderful thing. The greatest being close to us in recent times was the guardian of the faith, Shaul Yehudi. Obviously extraordinary. None of us are here to testify about that. When I was a new Baha'i, Shaul Yehudi was still alive. And it was so exciting to hear from pilgrims who had been in the Holy Land accounts of having met the guardian and seen him, heard his voice. From the beginning of my Baha'i life, I was thinking about that. I had some dreams about it, even about the Holy Land and seeing the Guardian. And the pilgrims would come back and tell these wonderful stories. I had that bounty of working with Jalal Qazi, who was a colonel in the Iranian army, in charge of certain tribal districts in Iran. So he had a pretty rough life, difficult life. Very devoted Baha'i, terrific storyteller. He was such a marvelous teacher, you know. And he was also a veterinarian. So he knew about farm animals and all these things, and helped the tribes with those matters as well. In the Guardian's, the difficulties that the Guardian faced with his family, and also with the coming of the Second World War, Shoghi Effendi suspended pilgrimage, both from the East and the West. Stopped completely. And it stopped for many years, from 41 until 51. Some 10 years of suspension. There were no pilgrims at all. There was an occasional visitor for one reason or another, military purposes or something that Shoghi Effendi would meet and greet, but it was very seldom that anybody had direct contact with him. That was a very difficult period. I've heard Maria Bonham, who told us herself, she said, there were those 10 years, Shoghi Effendi, I never saw him smile. He was so broken-hearted by the family having turned against him. The will and testament calls on us all to keep the guardian happy, to cheer him, so he would give everything that he has. And instead of that, we broke him with all of this terrible While the greatest Tony Leaf was alive, she kept the family in check. After her passing, the problems started to appear. By the 50s, it had really become bad. The band of the second, there were two, you realize there were two bands of enemies. The first band were those that didn't accept Abdu'l Baha as the center of the Kaaba. Okay, so that's those families. And they were the relatives. They were the two, there were two wives of Baha'u'llah that became co-emperors at that time. Not Nawab had passed away, but the two remaining. And their children, everybody together, leaked against Abdu'l Baha. Okay, these terrible, terrible people. Then, in the Guardian's time, his family began to break away from him. That was Abdu'l Baha's family, Abdu'l Baha's daughters, Abdu'l Baha's grandchildren. You know? These people separated themselves from, so they became a separate band of covenant breakers. Now, you would say these people would never associate with the enemies of the master. They were the master's family. And yet, in the early 50s, one of the Afnan, a very treacherous man, Nair Afnan, began creating liaisons between the grandchildren on both sides, the youth, and created marriages between the old covenant breaker band and the new covenant breaker band. Shoghi Effendi announces this in messages. It was very worrisome because it meant now these two clans would come together and form a force against the world center of the faith. All these problems are bearing down on him. And then he was inspired to launch the 10-year crusade. He launched the 2-year plan first, a 2-year plan in Africa. The various national assemblies during those 10 years were engaged in plans of different lengths, inspired and confirmed by the Guardian. But this was the first international plan. Each nation had their own plan, yes. But now he created an international plan for the first time. Four national assemblies were giving goals in Africa. Iran, Northeast Africa, the British Isles, and the United States. And they had to send pioneers, they had to see the translation of literature in tribal languages in Africa, they had to open a number of countries to the faith. And that went forward. As they went, the Bananis, the Nakhchivanis, the names some of you are quite familiar with, they went to Uganda, the Sabris also went there, some of the American pioneers, and the tribes of Africa began to come into the cause. There were enrollments in the hundreds. There hadn't been anything like that since the heroic age of the faith. You know, Tyre in her teaching and things would enroll hundreds of people. There was big waves of teaching with her movements and with some of the letters of the living. And Shoghi Effendi said that what was happening in Africa was reminiscent of the days of the early dawnbreakers and also of the apostles of Christ. And she said that brought joy back to him. The African campaign awakened Shoghi Effendi again. And then with that stimulus, he laid out then the World Crusade. So 51 to 53 was the 2-year plan, then 53 launched the World Crusade. In 1951, also at that very early stage where the State of Israel had been formed, the War of Independence, the very difficult situation in Haifa because it had Jews and Arabs living together and they were fighting and there were snipers on every house and it was a terrible situation. One of his close confidants, who was a gardener but also very close to the Guardian, had been running across the street from the Western Pilgrim House, coming to the Master's house, and he was shot dead at the gate of the Master's house, such as Shoghi Effendi sent a letter that said that the lion of the forest of the love of God has passed away. Sacrificed his life there. Very, very difficult times. In any case, he opened pilgrimage again. And from Iran, there were two pilgrims that were coming alone, the first ones. And one of them was Mr. Ghazi that I've been talking to. this is, he was a hand of the cross, but he wasn't yet a hand of the cross. It's just the first hands were also named at that time, the living hands by the guardian. So Mr. Kazi and Mr. Kaden was the other one. Both of these were destined in later, a few years later, to become hands of the cause of God. But they came as pilgrims. Mr. Kazi said, Mr. Furutan, I spoke to him he was the secretary of the NSA, about the what was it like, because Mr. Furutan had been on several pilgrimages before the doors were closed. And Mr. Kazi had heard different believers said, you know, I don't know, it's a good idea for you to go, because Shaggy Penny will read your thoughts. He knows everything you're thinking. And Mr. Kazi said, oh my God, what am I going to do? You know, I come from a rough background. I don't know what I'm thinking. And he knows that. He was thinking maybe he shouldn't come. So Mr. Furutan encouraged him to go, but he said, you know, be careful what you think. So he came on pilgrimage. And he and Mr. Auden were in the Eastern Pilgrim House, which is the pilgrim house nearest the shrine and on the mountain. That was the Eastern Pilgrim House. That was the general pilgrim house now, but it was the Eastern one. And in the afternoon of the first day that they were there, Shoghi Effendi was driven up in the car and brought there, because it was his custom, he would come in the afternoon, as I was mentioning with Mr. Ling, he'd come in the afternoon and walk with the pilgrims. So he said, we met the guardian, and he said, let us walk and visit the shrines, the gardens and the shrines. So he started walking, and he would make comments and talk about the cause on the way, victories and different things, different subjects. And at one moment, he said, we're just reaching to those white steps, the first walk that you have towards the shrine. He said, he turned to Mr. Potter and he said, he praised Mr. Potter for something, and Mr. Potter fainted. Mr. Potter was out cold, you know, on the ground. Shoghi Effendi is concerned. Shoghi Effendi's down on his knees. He has the head of Mr. Potter in his hands, and he's stroking his head and trying to get him to wake up. Mr. Kazi says, Mr. Gautam woke up, he opened his eyes, he saw the guardian's face right there, he passed out again. It took a little while to get him revived, but they got him back on his feet. Okay, now the two of them, they're going to the shrine now, together with the guardian. He says, we came to the shrine, and the custom of the guardian was to go to one of the two shrines. Of course, this was their first day, so they would go to the shrine of the Baha. But then on an alternate day, they would go to the shrine of Abu Baha, and then come again and go to the shrine of the Baha. Not like we go and, you know, we take all the shrines in one day. We don't have the guardian to guide us, so we take full advantage. So they go in the shrine together, and Shoghi Effendi goes forward to the threshold and approaches the tablet of visitation that's there, and he himself begins to chant. Imagine, the sign of God on earth is chanting the tablet of visitation. If you can't get close to Baha'u'llah that way, I don't know what's going to happen. Here he's chanting the tablet of visitation, and they were so stirred and thrilled. And Mr. Khadam, I remember saying after, he said, the guardian, there was such intensity when he was chanting, it was so beautiful. And he said his shoulder would lift and move like that with the intensity of, as he was chanting. So he says, then the guardian finished chanting, and with all devotion, he prostrated himself at the threshold briefly, and then he stood up, and with his back towards us, he said, he started backing out. Mr. Kazi and Mr. Kazi were standing on the two sides of the shrine, in the inner shrine there, and the guardian was coming back in, and they looked at each other like, what do we do now? Do we face the threshold, or do we face the sign of God on earth? You know? Mr. Kazi was a rather large, corpulent person, and he said, we half-halved it. Half towards the guardian and half towards the shrine. We didn't know what to do. so you went out and said, then we went forward and prostrated ourselves. But when we came out, Shogyakhandi had put his shoes on and he was pacing slowly back and forth. And we came out and we knelt down to put our shoes on. As we were putting our shoes on, Shogyakhandi said, the station of the shrine is very great. He said, the friends don't understand the station of the shrine. He said, we knew which friends he was talking about. So then he began extolling, he said, Mr. Khazir was telling me this story. He said, he began extolling the shrine of the greatness of the shrine of the Bab and quoting from scriptures about this shrine. And finally he said, we were hearing this and we came around the corner onto the front of the shrine, following the guard. He was walking ahead, we were walking behind and he was explaining. And then he said, and all of the prophets of God and the holy ones and saints of all ages, Baha'u'llah says, are circling around this holy spot. Okay. Mr. Akase said, not intentionally, but I said to myself, so what's left for Baha'u'llah? That was the thought he got when he said it. Oh, he thought, oh, that wasn't good. And sure enough, Shogyakhandi stopped. And he turned around and he looked right at Mr. Khazir. And he smiled and he said to him, and then all those holy ones that circle around the Bab, together with the Bab, circle around the Bab. So he says, you judge whether he reads thoughts or not. I don't know, but he's guided what to say to the pilgrims. And some of the pilgrims said, Shogyakhandi would answer their questions before they would have a question in mind, he would answer. And it isn't necessarily that we can't say that he read minds, but he was inspired by the powers that move through him, you know, to satisfy the pilgrims. There was a story by Helen Bishop. Helen Bishop was a very highly educated woman who had been traveling, and under the guardian's guidance, she'd gone to the East in Europe, and she'd gone all other places and would lecture at universities and so on. And at her invitation, she wrote the introduction to the first Western publication of the Kitab-e-Iqan. So she was quite a prestigious person. She's going on pilgrimage. She tells a story on herself. She says, I'm going to the presence of the guardian. I have to think up some really good questions. And questions that would demonstrate her depth of knowledge and understanding to call something. So she said, I had several of these questions in my mind when I was there, and then she was a Western pilgrim, so she was waiting upstairs. They announced that the guardian was in the dining room downstairs and the friends should come and join him there. So she said, I came down, I was the new pilgrim, so Shogyakhandi greeted me and they placed me at his right hand at the table. And then he began to, he greeted her, of course, but they were sitting. When they were sitting, she said, after that he ignored me. He spoke to the others. I had my questions ready, but he never turned to me at all. He spoke to everyone, lovingly encouraging. She said, I felt so isolated, I didn't know what was the matter. I was just suspended, really, without knowing what was going on. And she said, after about 20 minutes, the guardian warmly turned to me and he said, and now, he said, you must have some questions. And she said, and then I realized that I had come with all my plans, you know, and sure, instead of just being accepting whatever the guardian would want to say and speak, I had myself all clogged up with myself. And he said, so you must have some questions. And she said, I forgot them all. I couldn't remember any questions. But in the course of the pilgrimage, she did say, I did come up with one where I wanted to ask him, how could I improve the way I teach the faith? What would be the best way to do that? And she said, I couldn't have imagined his answer. He said to me, you should memorize the hidden words. And then that will influence, they will come into your teaching. She said, that was the last thing I imagined you'd say. But she said, I did it, and it had an extraordinary effect in my Baha'i speeches and talks and explanations and so on. And you know, there's several tablets of Abu Baha invoking us to memorize the hidden words. And at least sometimes I tell the youth in Haifa, write down, you've got a busy day ahead of you, you're busy all the time, write down one of the hidden words, put it in your pocket. When you have a moment, you're taking a drink of water, somebody look at that and memorize that and think about that hidden word all day. Do that every day for a while, you'll soon have a collection of it. And maybe in your lives you'd have a possibility of doing that. Very interesting experiences came out of pilgrimage for so many people. The second, the sets of quotations here, again you have the eternal king being Ali, if you want to recognize that. The tradition of Komail. Komail was a disciple of Ali, of the Imam Ali, and that's a quote from him. Notice how man stands as the noblest and most perfect of all created things. That's because man excelleth in all intensity this revelation of the light of God. And if you look at the hidden words, that's the key to all of this. Over and over in the hidden words, he talks about the light that's within you, the light that, the love that we've placed in you. The motivation of God creating us is love. You realize that that's the very nature of have I run over time? No, it's 8:30. We're all right. The very nature of the cause is love. The motivation of is the first reason for the cause is that God loved us. That's why He created us, He's engraved on us His image and revealed to us His beauty. He wants to name our name. This question of names is very interesting. It's the identity usually of something. You know, he taught Adam the names of all things, and that's why he had this great wisdom. If something doesn't have a name, it doesn't have an identity, you don't even remember it. But somehow our identity is connected with the names. And you've noticed perhaps in the prayers that almost all the prayers say, oh, praise be to thee, O my Lord, I implore thee by thy name. Sometimes just says by thy name to do such and such. Sometimes says by thy name the all merciful and puts one of the attributes. But oftentimes there's nothing there. And you go, as you read through these various prayers and meditations, you'll find passages where he says, I implore thee by him who is thy name. This is a kind of self-effacing way Baha'u'llah has of telling you to turn to him. I implore thee by thy name. It means I implore thee by you, Baha'u'llah. But it's the same as when he wants to announce his position in creation from the Sea of Child, what happened in the Sea of Child. He says, the maid of heaven appeared before me and announced unto all creation, this is your best beloved, and so on. Instead of himself saying, I am your best beloved. There's some marvelous divine theatrical elements here. Because what is the maid of heaven? He says it's a personation of his own inner spirit. It's not a separate entity that's above Baha'u'llah. It's the sign of the inner reality of the manifestation. And it's very interesting, you look at it in the history of its development. So you can be on page 100 of God Passes By and a couple other places. He talks about this. There's an evolution in the sign of the great spirit, or the most great spirit, in, as Baha'u'llah calls it, the Holy Spirit, Christians would call it, the faithful spirit, the Muslims call it. So that you have, in the case of Zoroaster, you have sacred fire as the element that's communicating to him, the sign of his own prophethood. And then you have the burning bush, in the case of Moses. So you've got a symbol, mineral symbol, then you have a vegetable symbol, then you have what's next? Christ? The dove. So you have an animal symbol, okay? What's next? Muhammad. You have Gabriel, a male angel. And interesting for you ladies to realize that the highest is this maid of heaven, the personation of the spirit is now in the feminine, the highest form is the feminine form. Never mind that all the great teachers of the internationally of the faith were women. There's a galaxy of Baha'i immortals that Shoghi Effendi talks about. And he names them off. I don't know how to memorize, but they include like Martha Root and Lua.
Dorothy Baker.
Eventually, but that came later. Lua is there, yes, and also Keith Ransom Kaler and so on. Then he says, and Hai Dun, and then he goes back to the women again. The whole galaxy is women except for Hai Dun. Lucky man, he's in there. The great radiant women, so this is quite interesting. He pronounces this at the time after Juliet Thompson's passing. He's saying she was joining, and Ella Bailey joined that group also, who was a pioneer of terrific sacrifice. She was a Baha'i in the Bay Area in the United States, and at the conferences they were calling for pioneers, and she offered to pioneer. She was in a wheelchair. And one of the other, another couple took her with them to Libya. She's buried outside Tripoli. And her grave, she gave up her grave plot in California and contributed that money to the cause at the beginning of the crusade. So she had no money of her own to pay for a grave. So Shoghi Effendi built her resting place in Havana. And it wasn't very long she was there, but he talked about the spirit of the cello that he had arisen in the crusade to go out with a broken bone and unable to walk. That's just interesting stories of the sacrifice that the gentlemen were telling us about, inspired by the Dunbar. Okay, I think we open it to some questions and answers. If you have some answers this evening. Not sure what I can come up with. Yes, sir. It's a personation. Shoghi Effendi uses this very interesting word, not personification, but personation. That is symbolized as if something's symbolized as a person. So his own inner spirit is personated as the maid of heaven. The spirit of Baha'u'llah himself. You can find that explanation in God Passes By and also in the message that that Shoghi Effendi sent with relation to preparations for the centenary of the Declaration of the God. God-given mandate is the name of the message. And there he talks about the successive signs of the Holy Spirit coming to the province of God. There was no doubt in the case of Christ, but there was a doubt, but it was symbolic. That's quite interesting. Yes, please.
What would the husband and wife be different levels of
spirit?
My question too is, can you tell us a bit about how this one message are written? I mean, sometimes some are very long and some are short.
Which the message?
This one message.
Sometimes there is one message. Oh, okay. Oh, that's an interesting one. I'll take that part first in the book. I don't know about your wife, I don't want to say that. About the Rizwan message. One time I was speaking to the pilgrims in the pilgrim house one evening during a pilgrimage, and there were a number of the staff were also there. And one lady said, excuse me, she said, after I said something, he asked her a question. She said, excuse me, she said, you know, I know that the House of Justice writes the Rizwan message. Well, what else does it do? And your reaction was the same as the pilgrims and the staff. They were all laughing. So in that mood, when I finally calmed down much that I could answer, I said, do you think it's easy to write the Rizwan message? A little bit about the various things that were going on. There was another man who had asked on another occasion, how often did the House members come to Haifa? Not realizing, you know, friends have different levels of experience and understanding. So they thought it's like the NSA, you know, once a month or once every 3 months the House would come and meet and write the Rizwan message and go home again. Now, so the subsequent question to that is, how do they write the Rizwan message? And the House of Justice, in my experience over the years, and some 22 years with this process, we would have a consultation late February based on the collection of statistical reports and various reports from the offices of the World Center and the International Bi-National Community from New York and Geneva, all of these things would come. We'd all read them, we'd think about them. Then we'd have this initial consultation about the Rizwan. What are we going to say in the Rizwan message? Now maybe there was a plan under operation, so that became clear that we were talking about the plan to some degree. If it was to launch a plan, that was also a very special year where we'd be in consultation with the teaching center and deciding on what would be the goals of the plan. So successive plans, you know, from the time we arrived at, that was after the 9-year plan that I came to Haifa, and then there was an initial 5-year plan, and then there were a whole series of plans up until we began the process of 5-year plans after 5-year plans after 5-year plan after 5-year plan. So anytime we say 5-year plan, you know that's the current plan. So that consultation would hear be several hours usually, and notes were taken by the members. And then at the end of that, everyone had talked, sometimes in response to something somebody else had proposed, or adding something new. So there was a whole spectrum of what would be the emphasis of the Rizwan message. And then the House would decide who would be the person or persons, sometimes be one, sometimes be two, to go together and draft the first draft reflective of that discussion that we had. So that would take, you know, maybe a couple weeks maybe to produce the first draft. Then the first draft would come one morning, that would be on the agenda, and we would read, the person would read out the whole message that had been drafted. And they'd read it all together first to have general responses, and then we'd go paragraph by paragraph and discuss the contents of it after that, after the general comments. And then the result of that is that we weren't ready to approve that message, and that had to go back and be revised according to the consultation. And that was draft one. Then they brought draft two. And then we did it again, and then they brought draft three, and then we did it again. Generally, there were 7 or 8 drafts before we had to. So the lady was right. And I was right too. You think it's easy? It took a long time. So you look back at those early Rizwan messages, there's so much contained in them. And lessons are given in them to some degree. There's a definition in one of them of what deepening consists of and the purpose of deepening in the song. Quite powerful. This long message. And sometimes then it would be short. It would be, more recently, the House of Justice has, the heavier messages have been to the Counselor's Conference. For instance, if it's the year of the Counselor's Conference, that's the major message that describes the plans in the December and January period, and then circulated, discussed with the NSAs to really get it ready to launch the plan with Rizwan. And then there's a short message launching the plan. But that's been a pattern that's been repeating itself every 5 years. So it varies from time to time. Now, you want to be with your wife in the next world or not? What is it? You know, they wrote the Guardian, they said, what about these soulmates? What if I've married someone that's not my soulmate and I'm going to get the next world and then I'm going to find a soulmate and I'm going to want her and I'm going to not want her? So he said there's no teaching of soulmates in the faith. That the relationship of the souls in the next world is based on the connections they've had here. So if in your marriage you're spiritually united and that goes together, you'll perhaps be together with your wife on a regular basis in the next world. So there's no giving and taking of marriage in the next world. So he says that the souls that you may be closest to may be your mother, maybe your best friend, maybe your brother, maybe your... So people say, well, which one of my three wives is it going to be? No. It's a question in America, at least. That depends, again, on the connection that you have. You may be associated with more than one of them. You may love one very much, and they passed away, and now you have another, and you love her too. So you'll all be together, because it isn't a question of marriage, sexuality, producing children. It's a marriage, it's a question of spiritual communion. And you'll be the closest with those that you're the most like, the similar to you. That's the guidance that's given us there. So, if you're close to your wife, there's a chance you'll be with her in the next world. If you're wishing to get rid of that connection, then you can't be very spiritual, and probably that will result in you not being with her. Please.
That's a correlation between the five kingdoms, the physical world and spiritual. Let's say that if we do not progress as we are supposed to, we can be a human in the next world, we can be a mineral in the next world. Now if I am a mineral in the next world, my wife is a human in the next world, there's a chance that she can see me, but I cannot recognize
her. Yeah, she may be walking my we don't become the mineral, it's like the existence of the mineral in this realm. In other words, if the soul doesn't develop any of its potentiality, it remains, it's the lowest, at the lowest stage in the next world. And that's what the mineral is in this world. So it's used as a likeness. It's not that we change into a stone or a mineral. Although you may find some of your relatives like stones, you know. That's part of it. But then the grace of God, the mercy of God, the power of prayers, of intercession, exists for all the souls around us. We should really be praying for mankind on the one hand, for family on the other, for relatives of all sorts. Who's got that? Please.
Mr. Dunbar. Shuke Philip talks about the secularization of the Middle East, isn't it? And we see a lot of these things going on over there and so on and so forth. And, I mean, do you think that that's a good step? I mean, in the sense that it sort of prepares the people for the faith in those countries, which is, you know? And I think related to that also is all these current events that are going on in that part of the world. And in this part of the world, we also see an increasing rise in fundamentalism, you know, in neighboring countries, Malaysia, India, Brunei. So just my main question is secularization maybe an important intermediary step towards, you know, greater acceptance of the faith?
I don't really have an answer on that. I'd have to think about it for a while, but the secularization, it seems to be, is there on the one hand, but also the fanaticism of these various religious groups is growing. So I don't know whether it's more secularization or less secularization. You know, that's happening in the very severe in the States. You can't. Somebody said to A teacher said to another teacher in a school, well, I hope you have a blessed day. And they took offense, and they took it, and the person was punished because they'd said this word, have a blessed day. Can you imagine? It's kind of, that's fanaticism, the secular level now, you know? And the Middle East is a very special area. I think we have to be really cautious in these days. We have the problem that if we just, as Baha'is, we say, if this is a political matter between the Palestinians and the Israelis, and I really can't comment on that, you know, then they say, oh, then you're for the Israelis, you know, because otherwise you'd be condemning them. And it's very delicate. You just have to stick to that line. And that's what Allah has given us as the way out through this very difficult passage, because if we all opened up with what our views are about the situation between the Arabs and the Israelis in this room, we would be totally disunited after that. Just the safety of us is to not enter into a discussion of the value of what's happening this way or that way. As Baha'is, we have indications in the writings that Baha'u'llah has invited the Jews back to the Holy Land. And Shoghi Effendi has said quite clearly that the reason they're there, the reason they've been chosen to come back at this time, is to perform a protective shell around for the world order, for the eventual birth of a divine civilization. We wouldn't be there if there was no Israel. So, as Baha'is, in one sense, we have to be grateful for it. That doesn't mean we support the political positions they take or so on, but we don't want it to disappear. What will happen to our world center? We had the Baha'is persecuted in neighboring countries because we had our shrines in Israel. For decades, that's been a problem. Things will happen. Even Shoghi Effendi said they pilgrims, again a pilgrim, not, but he said, the Baha'is said to Shoghi Effendi, well, surely the shrines will be protected because there's all these rockets and wars and threats and so on. He said, not necessarily. He said, if they're destroyed, they will be rebuilt in the future. I hope that that stage doesn't come. It's a horrible thought to think that the World Center gets destroyed, but we don't know what's coming. But there, spread thy skirts, O Jerusalem, in the tablet of Ahmad, in the tablet of Karma. There are things indicative that Israel has to grow. It's going to be a mighty nation. It's going to be one of the greatest nations of the world. These are not popular concepts now. And we don't have everything published that's in the writings about it. But we do have some pretty strong things from the Guardian saying that the Muslims were responsible for the rejection of the faith and for the killing of the Blessed Bab and the persecution, both Shias and Sunnis, of Baha'u'llah and his exile to the Holy Land. And think what happened, he says, to the Jews for 3 years of persecution of Christ. Now imagine that. 40 years of persecution, 50 years of persecution of the two twin prophets of this day, what's going to happen to the Muslims? Hard to imagine. So that's part of the situation. We can't really discern exactly how, but better to be reserved in our judgment of the whole situation. But we should be praying. We lament the death of any innocent people. And there's all kinds of rewards after losses for those that die in war, or children that die because of conflicts. I hope we'll get the world to a stage where we can stop all violence of this sort, really. This is the goal. And instead of worrying about what's happening there, we should be teaching the faith so that we can create that atmosphere in the world which will support peace and the elimination of armed conflict. Please.
So I just wanted to ask about the periods in time that faith moves on.
periods and epochs and things like that.
Yes.
How are those determined?
How are they determined?
How are they determined in their history?
Most have been determined. Abdu'l-Bahá talks about the cycles, you know, the universal cycles of the coming of the manifestations. And he says we're in the universal cycle that began with Adam, and whose universal manifestation is Baha'u'llah. And it's 500,000 years plus the 6,000 preliminary years from Adam until now. But he said there were universal cycles prior to that. But all traces of them have vanished. But the world is ancient, he says, very ancient indeed, and these cycles have always existed. So that's the question of universal cycles. The implication, and some pilgrims, there have been some mentioned pilgrims of these studies, the implications of unity is that this is, and we saw the quotes here today projected, that the highest stage of organization of this planet is the unification of the human race, the oneness and wholeness of the human race. That's the finish of social evolution on this planet. So Shoghi Effendi said in the future there will be a manifestation that will unite all the planets of our solar system. This is early for us. We don't even understand if where they are their civilization, where they are. This is all early. But I mean, that would be the kind of logical step you would say, if that's the way we go, the unification of the planet, then the next thing is unity with other realms, other existences. I don't know how that works. And we probably won't find out in our lifetime, but from the other side, we can ask those questions to somebody who can answer.
Abdu'l-Bahá mentioned about the common faculty that connects the body to the soul. Have you come across some more detailed explanation of this?
No. The relationship of soul, mind, and spirit is dealt with, but the common faculty is like between the outer senses and the inner senses that he mentions, you know, some answered questions. But that's the only reference that I know of to that particular subject.
Okay. And then
it has some parallel, I think, in the Greeks as well, though. It's...
And in the case of the Bab, have you come across in the writings as to the personification of the Holy Spirit for the Bab?
Yes. You'll find it in the Dawnbreakers, in the notes. The Bab prior to his the declaration of his mission, that is some time prior to that, because he also has some writings before his declaration. He had a dream in which he saw the head of the Imam Hussein suspended from a tree, and it was dropping blood, and he took his hand and he took some of that blood, and that woke him to his divine mission. It's a bit out of the order of the other ones, but...
Yeah, I was thinking about that.
Pretty intense story. It's interesting that it's Hossein. It's interesting that it's Hossein, you know, because of Baha'u'llah identifying himself as the return of the Imam Hossein. Such an exalted person, and he chooses one of the Imams that he says he's... This really elevates the position of the Imam Hussein, and Baha'u'llah reveals a tablet of visitation for us to say, to attain the presence of the Imam Hussein also. So it's not been translated, but it's there. All right, friends. Time for some... Oh, please.
Can I ask a question related to the hiddenness?
Yes, you can try. I don't know.
Now, I noticed there is one concept that Baha'u'llah repeats three times with almost identical words in the hidden word. And yet the hidden word is such a condensed version of all these details. The three passages is plant the seed the pure, in the pure soil of the heart, and water with the water of certitude. until the Hanxin spring up fresh and green from the holy city of the heart. Mm. And he repeated three times with almost identical words.
Yes.
So I was puzzling, in such a condensed version of all his teaching, why he repeat three times this concept.
I guess he wanted you to ask that question. That's three times. Ponder on the significance of why it's repeated. He wants you to understand, really, let's get this one straight now. There are seeds within us that need the watering of the Word of God to spring forth and bring forth their wisdom and knowledge. It's a beautiful concept. Beyond that, I don't know. You may have a little delay, and then you can ask the author himself. Thank you for tonight. We'll see you again.